In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Glory to Jesus Christ.
Glory forever.
My dear brothers and sisters, this is the first Sunday after Pentecost. And it's a Sunday of celebration. It's a Sunday of celebration because we are a living church. And it is important for us on this 1 week after we celebrate the descent of the Holy Spirit upon the church, which is the birth of the church, which gives authority to the church, which makes the church that vessel that sustains us through this life until we get to the next life. It's important that we recognize those who have fought the good fight, and as St. Paul has said, those who have completed the course, completed the race, and remain faithful to the Lord under all circumstances and conditions. Great is their reward, for they inherit everything that God has in his redemptive work has promised us. Restoration with the Father, eternal blessedness in his kingdom that will have no end, a joy that we can't even possibly imagine. And again, Scripture, Christ in Scripture best describes what this life after the earthly life will be like. And I've said it many times, and I'm sure you've heard it from me many times. The eye hasn't seen, the ear hasn't heard, nor has it ever entered into the heart of man what God has prepared for those who believe in him. Now you should need no other incentive than to be a saint. What you just heard. Saints. Who are the saints? You've got a church full of all kinds of saints. But who are they? Dearly beloved, they don't come out of the Marvel comic books. They're not super people. They're people like you and me. They're people who have loved the Lord and have strived to live in his image. And because they've strived and they never, ever gave up, because they persevered, what they didn't accomplish in victory by their efforts asking God's help, God ultimately gives them the victory anyway. Again, remember, the eye has never seen, the ear has never heard, nor has it ever entered the heart of man what God has prepared for those who believe in him. You need proof of this statement? What did Jesus do for us? He left his throne with the Father. He chose to obey his Father's will and to take on the flesh of humanity for the sake of humanity. In his human nature on earth, he lived a difficult life. He lived a life of solitude. He lived a life of sacrifice. He lived a life where the pleasures that you and I take for granted and feel that we absolutely must have, without. The one thing that he did have is he had eternal life. Because he's the author of life, and death has no claim on him. Death is a consequence of sin. Death comes from the devil. But yet he even chose for us to take upon human death, because he knew that's the only way death could have been defeated. He had to meet it face to face. That was our worst enemy in all of human nature, and only he could defeat and destroy and send that enemy into oblivion. So he chooses to die to meet death face to face. In the words of St. John Chrysostom are so valid. O grave, where is thy victory? Death, where is thy sting? It's all gone. Because God took that enemy and just went like that to him. And it no longer existed. Oh yeah, we passed through it. But it's a doorway. Nothing more than that. It's a doorway that's going to lead to eternity in one form or another. We are going to either be with God or without God. And if we chose to live a life without God, it was better that we should have been born. Because that's everlasting agony. God has overcome all of that because he loves us so much. So who are the saints? They're people like you and me. In the early days of the church, and I'm sorry, I regret that we lost this. If you read the epistles, and you look at the church in Corinth, or the church in Ephesus, or the church in Rome, or the church in Galatia, it's not referred to as I just called it. When people spoke about the church in another country, they said, and how are the saints in Galatia? How are the saints in Rome? How are the saints in Ephesus? That was so much a part of their vision, they lived it. They called each other saints. We run away from it. Who, me? Yeah, you. You're called to be a saint. And God wants you to be a saint. And God will do everything in his power and in his providence for you to acquire that sainthood. All you have to do and all I have to do is say to him, yes. What does that mean? It means if you confess before men, God, I will confess you to my Father who is in heaven. However, if you deny me before men, I'm going to deny you before my Father. And you do not want that denial. Now here's where it gets a little bit tougher. If you love your father or mother, you're not worth of me, he says. If you love them more than you love me. Or if you love brother or sister more than you love me, you're not worthy of me. Wow. That sounds hard. Why would Christ say that? Because Christ traveled the road for us. He loved us so much that he ascended the cross for us, that his blood would wash away our sins. And that through the washing away of those sins by his blood, there's no need anymore for a blood sacrifice. That's why he can say that. He gave up everything for us so that we can be with him and his Father. Yes, we are to love our mother and father and brother and sister, but we love God before all things. There may be a situation in life where mother or father or brother or sister may see something so vile and contradictory to the truth given us by Christ that we have to stand up and say, no. And God calls us to do just that. And then Peter says, well, Lord, we've done that. We gave up all of our possessions. We have wives and children. Most of the times we're not with them. We're out preaching the word so the world may know you, the only true God, and the fullness of the kingdom that comes only through you. And he says, well, what do we have? God, without hesitation, says, well, because you've done all of that, when I sit at the throne of my Father at the second coming, you are going to have 12 thrones on either side of me. And you will help me judge Israel. And then together forever we will be with the Lord. So we better start thinking in terms of forever. That only comes by being saved. Don't run away from that. It's your calling, it's my calling. May through God's providence someday we be remembered in this church militant as members of the church triumphant. For so it is God's will. Amen.
Amen.